Peter. Anyway, my name is Kerstin Johnson-Cissé. I work here at SIDA as a lead policy specialist on agriculture. And I am also the Swedish focal point to the Global Donor Platform for Rural Development that this whole day is about. We will hear more very soon. We'll hear more about the platform. And the people on here in front will be introduced very soon. So the first part will be about the platform, the how it can be used for us, the donors and members. And then we have a second part of this seminar from 1:30 that will be about, we will focus on achieving food security in the face of climate change, where we will have keynotes and comments both in real life here and also over the video. So before I forget, I will want to wish you a very warm welcome to this meeting. It's a difficult week. Many things are happening, many seminars. Schools are finishing, and I know that people are extremely busy, so I'm very happy to see you all here. And especially welcome, a special welcome also to those of you who follow us over the web stream. So we hope now that the technique will be with us for the coming hours. When I was thinking about this introduction, because I wanted to say something about the Global Donor Platform from a Swedish perspective, and I actually happened to bump into those who used to work with agriculture in SIDA back in time, who is now no longer here anymore in at SIDA. And then I learned to know that even before the actual Global Donor Platform was established, there was in the beginning of the 90s already a rather lively collaboration between donors that wanted to push agriculture and rural development higher on the development agenda. And Sweden at that time was particularly active around the 1996 when there was this World Food Summit, for example, in Rome. Today, the Swedish support to rural development and agriculture is around 5% of the total contribution or total support to development, and we are striving to increase these figures, of course. The platform is one way of working with increasing support to agriculture, and the platform, it's what we do it to. It's the platform is its members, actually. And I think that the potential effect of a global donor platform, the potential effect is actually much more than the individual members' different contributions. So we'll hear more about the opportunities we have with the platform. Also, we have called this, the working name for this whole event was the Roadshow. And I want to say a special welcome to the Secretariat and to the co-chair, Brian Baldwin. You will sitting here and soon having the word. Special welcome and special thank you to coming here up to Stockholm to meet with us. And because the idea was actually to bring the Secretariat and the Global Donor Platform to its members and users, if I might say. So this is, I think it's the first experience of this roadshow. So you're all with us in this test case. I hope it works out well. So with this, I'll just stop and say welcome and hand over to Melinda Sundell from CIANI, she will tell us the abbreviation of CIANI, a network for agriculture here in Sweden. Melinda will moderate throughout the day together with Matthew Fielding, and I'll hand over to you. Thank you.
Okay. All right, I think that we'll try to get going as quickly as we can. It's a great pleasure for those of us from SIANI, which is the Swedish International Agricultural Network Initiative, to be facilitating the activities of another larger network, which is very active in the same field that we are. I'm Melinda, and I'll be moderating. It's a bit of a bright light here, so you might have to wave for me to see you. It's not that I'm not getting your little subtle motions. And I'd like to introduce you to our network coordinator, Madeleine Fogde. Where are you, Madeleine? There? Okay. And Matthew Fielding. Matthew, wave. There is the person who will be checking the Twitter and the comments on the live streaming on the website of the Global Donor Platform. so please, those of you who aren't in the room, also feel that you're very welcome to make comments. I have a participant list here. I'm going to send around to those who are actually in the room. And we're very, very happy from SIANI that this achieving food security in the face of global climate change is the topic for this discussion. We'd like to let you know that your summary for policymakers with these famous seven recommendations came out in November of last year. Already in December, we organized a training event together with FAO where we use these as the framework for discussing the tools we use to look at carbon balances. They are perhaps not a startlingly new collection of recommendations, but they are very comprehensive and particularly, in our view, important in that they balance production with consumption aspects. For when we're talking about food security, it's not just the production of food that concerns us. We're also very concerned about nutrition and access to food on the consumption side. So first, we are going to learn a little bit about how the platform actually works. And I understand that I will hand over the word to Brian first, who is the co-chair of the platform and active at IFA, to describe that for us, please.
Thank you very much, Melinda. Thank you very much. And also, thank you, Kristin and to CEDA for hosting today's event and the roadshow, which is very important to us in the platform. I'm very pleased personally to be back in Scandinavia as a Landbrugsekonomista from what used to be called Norges Landbrugs High Schooler. I have a strong affection and closeness to Scandinavia, and this is a wonderful chance to come back to Scandinavia and to Stockholm, which I visited before. Also to see friends from CEDA, from Mats and Marie in the audience, who we work closely with on the platform. I'm very pleased to see a few moments ago Karen Isaacson, who, wearing my IFAD hat, together we were working on the IFAD Sri Lanka program. We had a very close working relationship with Swedish CEDA, who was supporting IFAD in agricultural smallholder development, with smallholder nutrition and domestic food supply. It was a very encouraging relationship that we had with the team. So that's my background. I'm an IFAD staff member in Rome, International Fund for Agricultural Development, and very happy to have been the co-chair of the Global Donor Platform for the last few years. And I want to use this opportunity to describe a little bit about what the platform is, and implicitly, therefore, for you to understand at CEDA and also from Finland, and I'm very glad that Sanna-Liisa has come across from Helsinki, because Finland is part of the platform as well, to understand what the platform does and how you're able to contribute to it. The platform was formed in 2003 by now 34 member organizations, and Sweden and Finland both joined in early days in 2005. And then Sweden became a board member in 2009, and very happily, Finland joined that this year as members of the board. 34 member organizations, but very much focusing all of us on the importance of agriculture and rural development central to poverty reduction. If we're looking at the MDB goals, we're looking at poverty alleviation. Where is poverty most prevalent in many of the countries that we work in the rural areas? So we find that therefore the networking and the knowledge exchange between us as donors and also lobbying within our institutions is important. Many of the institutions are concerned to improve the quality of development assistance to ARD and focus more of our budgets on the ARD programs. But understanding as we work together the need for a coordinated global approach, particularly since the Paris Declaration, the work that's gone on since then with the Accra High Level Forum and most recently the Busan Outcome Document, many of our the countries that we work in need donors to be on the same page, not having high transaction costs with government, and that equally, and I think importantly, applies to the agricultural sector. So what the platform is doing then is networking for partnership, and it was really very pleasing to hear about Siani this morning and the work it's doing here in Sweden. We're networking for partnership between all the organizations that you can see on that slide, the World Bank, FAO from the multilaterals, African Development Bank, joined an active member a few years ago, and the bilaterals, with Sweden and Finland leading the Scandinavian network. This issue of the knowledge that we believe is important came through strongly at our most recent annual general assembly, which we held in Berlin in January. As you've seen from the array of equipment on the left-hand side of the room here, it's all about knowledge tools. How do we get messages across? How can we communicate with each other? We talk about the tools that are going to be the roots of our networking for knowledge. We're talking about our members who come to us and say, this is what our organizations want to focus on. This is what we want to network about. That gives us the opportunity to start to develop thematic areas and to start to harvest that knowledge and start to share that knowledge around our membership. We all realize that our resources internally are very, very tight. They're getting tighter in the present financial climate. We need to share our knowledge and share our skills for what we're able to achieve. On the basis of that tree of ideas, and we stressed at the annual general meeting in Berlin that tree, I'm just going to flick back to it, every idea on that tree, you can't see the little post-it notes, but those post-it notes were put there by the members themselves, those 34, meant that the members themselves were interested and committed to working on those themes. It wasn't that they wanted to give it to someone else to do, they said no. We want to work on that theme. We're prepared to do that and network that information. What were the themes then that came out of our discussions? Aid effectiveness and results was a key issue. Again, pushing on from Busan and Paris. But as you all know, your taxpayers here in Sweden, just as my taxpayers back in the UK, are demanding to know where their money goes and is it achieving results. Results is coming through as a strong network. The importance of agricultural research is coming through. Canadian CEDA is particularly keen in our group to lead that. The Africa support program through CADEP has been an important theme. Climate change, again, we wanted to bring our knowledge of what we believe will be interesting to Swedish CEDA and to Finland here today on climate change and resilience in agriculture. Gender equity in youth is clearly one of our issues, and it's been CEDA that's been pushing that as a theme within the platform. Nutrition and agriculture, pastoralism and livestock has been coming through from the Horn of Africa experience. And again, still the importance of the post-harvest losses. How much is being lost at the farm level to post-harvest losses? We can increase production, but if we lose that production immediately after harvest, it's of no use to anyone. And I just wanted to emphasize again one of the diagrams that came through from the annual general assembly on what we're doing in terms of nutrition. That group is now thinking of a policy brief they're going to put together. That policy brief will be circulated by the platform, and it'll be used to try and develop the thinking and the approaches of our other members in terms of their agricultural policy approach. So guiding what does the platform do, how does it allocate its resources, we've developed a small strategic plan that's highlighted those areas, highlighted the importance of advocacy and knowledge exchange. And again, our annual report, which is going to be coming out any moment now, according to Pascal, as soon as EFAD finishes its input, is going to be talking about this importance of of networking, one of our key pieces of work that will be coming out this year. I want to talk a little bit more about the importance of knowledge exchange. Pascal's going to go into some of the details of this in a few moments. What's driving the work that we do and the focus on this is try to avoid duplication, even within our institutions. You well know that within your institutions, obviously different groups doing the same thing. We find that also within our own membership. We want to avoid the duplication, inform others what we're doing, take out what are the best practices, and we're going to be talking about a little bit later, and Elwin Granger Jones from EFAD, when he talks about climate later on, we'll be talking about climate smart agriculture. Cross-referring information sources, where can you find information? This is where the platform's website comes to the fore, where you can go and find links to information that you need. And increasingly, this important point, providing a space for interaction between policymakers and practitioners. Again, it's why we've tried to got Twitter online today. What sort of interaction can we get between our membership and our clients on the issues of climate change? And the platform is trying to develop that space for that through events like today, but other events that we hold throughout the year. When we formed the platform in 2003, agriculture was low down on the international agenda. It was low down on agencies' agenda. And advocacy was important then to get the profiles and the budgets within agencies higher and also within the larger environment. So it's still an issue. And as financing becomes tighter from our donors, we believe there's still an important advocacy message in generating and promoting common messages of the importance of the agricultural sector and raising the profile of ARD in various fora. That means that, for example, the platform, and again, and its members, was present at the Agriculture and Rural Development Day and the COP17 in Durban. The platform had both been present in the previous meeting in Cancun, as well as in Copenhagen. We went to the high-level forum in Busan, where the platform hosted some knowledge events with civil society and the private sector, and then joined together with EFAD, World Food Programme, and OECD, specifically looking at food security. It was a packed agenda at Busan, but we got a high audience recognition for bringing agriculture onto the agenda at the high-level forum in Busan. Again, I mentioned earlier, our most recent annual General Assembly in Busan, a very good networking event, produced all those themes of work that we were been developing in 2012. And particularly in 2012, on the back of some work we did last year, supported with the Overseas Development Institute in London, we've been looking at the strategic role of the private sector. It's recognized that we are not going to have enough donor funding to provide the investment that the agricultural sector needs. If donors can't provide that, where does that financing come from? It can come from the public sector, from governments in country. It's also going to have to come from private investors, both local and foreign. Arguably, most importantly, local investors. What guidance, therefore, do individual donors need to work better with domestic private sector and foreign private sector to support and encourage agriculture investment? It's not always about land, but there are issues about land, and you know the debate that's going on about the land grab. And bear in mind, in that debate, the major transactions are domestic, not foreign. How can you stop illegal purchase of land by domestic investors? That's one thing you will not find in the newspapers. That's the debate that we need to have. But there's a lot of work still to be done in the private sector, and EFAD has been working closely with one or two of the donors, one of our work streams, of how we can do a little bit more coordination with the private sector in improving agricultural investment in ARD. So just to begin to close again, some of the examples of our work. As I mentioned earlier, we have the synthesis paper on agricultural research prioritization with EFAD, with Canadian CEDA, with FAO. We will be not going to Rio. We're observing the importance of carbon emissions, and the platform will be based in Bonn and will be based in Bonn, but networking with all our members, feeding in results and ideas that are coming out of Rio and posting those onto the global platform's website. And again, expanding the use of our current knowledge and exchange technology, using events like this to develop knowledge, using our WebEx meetings, which we hold now fairly regularly to take a particular point of view, 45 minutes discussion, because time to all of us is precious, a 45-minute discussion linking a particular issue. And we'd very much like to get from you today, from Finland and from Sweden, ideas of topics that you would like us, the platform, to come back to you in a month or so's time and said, right, we're going to have a 45-minute session on this topic or this topic. So please give some thought to those ideas about what you'd like to see the platform circulate back to you in terms of knowledge. I'll close there with a thank you again to Kirsten and the team here from CEDA for arranging this afternoon's event, and I hold back to you, Melinda. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for that very succinct and detailed presentation. I know that all of us are eager then to know about the roots in the tree of the diagram we saw, which are the knowledge exchange tools. And Pascal Courbet, who is the communications officer for the Secretariat, will give us a discussion about
Thank you very much. Good afternoon, everyone. While I'm getting ready here and get the other presentation on. All right, so I hope you appreciate we're really trying to push the technology a little bit, you know. So as you can see, so it takes sometimes a little bit. It's all live, though. It's not, we are recording, but this is still live. So I think what is important to note is what Brian has said already, that essentially communications is and knowledge exchange is actually what the platform is all about. The knowledge is all retained within all the different organizations. And the job, especially within the Secretariat, is to facilitate, to get that knowledge flow going. And I would think that probably very important is to not just stay within those buzzwords, but actually, you know, get it actually going. And if you think of the tree that Brian had just introduced, there's the KX tools. The tools would actually be the fabric that actually makes that link between the members, and on that fabric the exchange would take place. And I think what makes the platform unique and where the added value is that it's not all about these little nitty-gritty datas about country A and X and Y and Z, but it's more on that higher level where members can actually exchange on how to do things. And ideally also what they would do in the future, not just now, but also in the future, to actually coordinate better where they're going with their activity. So let me just go into a couple of tools that we use. This looks very familiar to all of you. That's basically what our shared calendar looks like. And you can see there's a whole lot of telcos going on. And these telcos are not just basically calling 3-4 people, they all set up with agendas and there's minutes coming out, so people have from our membership have integrated themselves into a work group, for example, on agricultural research, and there, for example, you have once a month on average a telco where there's actual commitments, discussions about the budget from the platform side and how to move on as a group and produce policy briefs and studies for certain aspects. So this is basically just to show you what we do. These are the minutes that come out then, as you can see. And then we go in towards the website. The website is obviously a very big retainer of the knowledge. We have different sections, news stories at the bottom, and we have upcoming events which are basically fit by the calendar. And the calendar looks very bland, but you might have all seen it. If you really go into it, we put calendar entries in there, and we can see that this event just on our website has gotten 1,000 hits in that small span that we actually had it up until just before I checked before we came here. And it turns out to be, especially prospectively, quite a good tool to inform members and also wider constituencies out in Kenya, wherever, that are not really donor or practitioners integrated in our work, but maybe more on the recipient side, to actually see what's going on. And we're not publishing just events there that are already there with other organizations, but also what we do internally a little bit. So for example, you can see there's also one item there that says ARD related events in Rio. There we did a compilation of what we found is all ARD related that is going on, what kind of events are going on in Rio. And believe it or not, also has, I think, almost 1,000 hits for people interested in where that all feeds together. Then we have also about every 6 weeks for our members primarily, we have our a newsletter, an electronic newsletter that informs our membership on different items that are now that had just happened. This is looking backwards more, and you can see here, for example, let me introduce that as well, the CADEP DP task team. It's a donors hooked together talking about CADEP, the Comprehensive Africa Agriculture Development Program. And the next DP stands for the development partners, and the task team is the group of donors that come together. And if I go to the next slide, there's another newsletter just used by that CADEP DPTT to inform the agriculture donor working group staff members in Africa primarily on certain things that this group feels is not really communicated well to them. It's primarily information that is available but is somehow not really facilitated to getting through. So we're also coming in there to actually provide that fabric and in there. And the subscription list for this newsletter that you can forward it, and obviously people can subscribe to it again, is also in the hundreds already. I think it also goes up to 1,000 by now. So this also, you can see that it actually, there is quite a lot of pickup. It's also produced in French, by the way. And there you can see that actually grows, people are interested. Now, what's been mentioned there before, now pushing the technology side even more, is the virtual briefing. And for this, we do use a software that's called WebEx by the company Cisco. And the idea is you have a conferencing tool, like you know from the video conference. That tool is used to actually have different people online. They can speak to each other like on a video conference, but they can sit at their desk and communicate with headsets there and also do presentations at the same time. I will go and start this just now, and then you can see how it's actually done. See, now I'm the trouble is not switching over to the, so we can't do it now. Wait. Can you move it over to so we can see the, was it in here? Is it in the internet? You do. So, I just have to move it to the right. There's this other screen is here on the side. It's great. Okay. Okay. So there you can see this is the virtual briefing going on. So we had a particular subject that was introduced by Mary Laura from Switzerland, and she has here in the center here, she has her PowerPoint type of presentation, and she goes in there. You can see her speaking, and the other members are watching at their screen, and they just start discussing certain issues. They can give their input. And we're now looking into expanding this also to have a more of a outer audience, like we have with the live stream, you know, that can actually listen in. Maybe not so much really talking with people at the same time. That's not possible if you have a couple hundred. But you have an inner circle that discusses things, that applies, goes in, listens, and discusses with Mary Lore there, for example. And then the wider audience can actually use Twitter and so forth to come in. That's the second part that we're looking at now to actually expand this. And we actually had requests for today here to make that available and also have people dialing in and being even more actively involved. So now you would have to tell me, how do I get the screen back over, because it's here on the side. Just do that. Okay. It just comes out the off there, great. Okay. All right. Okay. Now we have a similar thing. I don't need to show you that now. A similar thing is videos. We use the same technology to do one-on-one interviews. So we have, for example, here there was Usman. We have some newer videos as well, where we think there's an issue that G8 was just coming up, and our member David Hegwood is obviously on the American side, very, very much involved with the whole G8 process right now. So we sit in front of the system, he sits there, and we ask questions and do a one-on-one interview that we record online with the system and place it there, and then obviously you can later on launch your comments and so forth. And it's also a tool we've used it about 10 times now with the new technology, and it's still very much coming. So basically it's also a promotion right now to make you aware that these things are there, and also maybe come up with suggestions for what else could be where it could be applied. Now moving a bit quicker here, this is basically, it looks very familiar to you. This is an online chair facility where members can, under a certain subject, this is the DP task team's workspace, can share documents with one another. So it's basically like a drop and lift box of information that is not necessarily private, but there they can also share drafts when they talk about. And there's also connected to that is a SharePoint, like you know from your organizations, where they can simultaneously almost work on certain documents, which is a challenge to do usually when you do interagency work, because you have huge IT departments, and usually it's not that easy to actually get them together. Within one organization it's difficult enough, but here this is sort of unique because it's not that easy to get people involved on SharePoints with coming, the one has Lotus system, the one that, and the one. So this is basically what this is for. Yeah, this is also on the website. It's basically showing what you see there in the back, a whole number of different publications that have been developed. They're all available also as PDFs with links to, as you know, the platform knowledge pieces have been mentioned before. They were commissioned out for private sector and a number of other issues. So there are more substantial works, and others are a bit smaller. Okay. Obviously, platform is involved in important meetings. The AGA, the Annual General Assembly that Brian had just mentioned, once a year, is actually the flagship event where all the members come together, and also other friends of the platform and talk about very important issues. This year, for example, David Nabarro was there, summarized a lot of the discussion there. And then you have at the bottom here, as you can see, there is the dialogue event, what we have right now. We participate in knowledge fairs and in all sorts of other events. And for that, we produce not just the regular banners, posters, flyers, and so forth. We're trying to bring flowcharts together to actually get the information out in a more structured way, and not just sort of do add aesthetic value to the event by placing posters there, but also to support the flow of information. And obviously you have what you've seen before. This is where you see actually what we're doing right now. This was taped before. And then when we have certain events, we report on that to quite some extent on our website from different events, but also we support the sort of policy maker outreach for example, with what we come to now, the climate change side, with the CCAFS Commission, when it comes to reaching out to donors and policymakers. That's, I think, where the platform has a unique USP to try and take those recommendations and really reach the policymakers. That's then also obviously placed on the website. That's the beginning of the video, or no, that's the middle of the video that we see later on. That's something that the platform could look into also a bit more. That's producing sort of online videos that explain certain issues by using charts and moving picture to get the issues more aesthetically conveyed to different audiences. We'll see that probably at the end of the whole event. This is something that we could look also a bit more in. This was done by the CCAFS Commission. This is just basically showing how these things are then explained in plain English. It's a podcast, so people can see it online. It's just a visualization of that. Yeah, and then I think that's all discussed. We can have more training type webinar functions with our system in the future. And we're also thinking about from the secretariat side to have more comprehensive contact databases to make the contacting of the different members in between each other easier. And what comes with that is also trying to develop an instant messaging service, like you maybe know from Skype. You can send messages to hook up the members in a group, like Yammer is one software that was used before, so that they can actually contact straightforward quickly with each other and sort of create more of a group. Let's see. Yeah, that's it. Okay.
Wow. That was not only interesting and informative, but I think also shows a little bit the fact that we're being used as guinea pigs here, when the even the ones who know the technology have a little bit of a few glitches. We have time for comments and questions. I think that when Brian's description of what the platform does, who the members of it are, and how it works, and then your description of the tools actually blend very well together. So I think we could have comments and questions addressed to either of these. And okay, we're going to begin. Let's see. I have trouble seeing, but Gunnel, I think you had your hand up. And please say your name first and then make your comment. Oh, sorry. And wait for the microphone. Three instructions. Yes.
My name is Gunnel Axelsson Nykander. I'm from Church of Sweden International Department. And I have actually two questions. The first is about the kind of dialogues you have. I see that most of the tools and the dialogues you have are really among the members, of course, because that's the purpose. But my question is what kind of dialogues you have vis-a-vis the recipient countries on the one hand and civil society on the other hand, both in recipient and donor countries. And secondly, you were mentioning, and it was shown up in some of the pictures, that the work on CADEP. And I have a specific question then about what the kind of work this group is doing. And I also have a piece of information to share, actually. It's a report produced by a network called APRODE, which is the faith-based aid organizations in Europe, together with PELUM, which is an Africa-based network. It's called Agriculture Research in Africa, Why CADEP Should Follow ISTED. So it's actually a critique of the fourth pillar CADEP in the light of the ISTED recommendations. So my question is really, if I want to share this with the network or the platform, who should I send it to?
Good, excellent.
Okay, I think...
we take some more questions.
All right, that's fine. I see Ingolia back there. He needs a microphone.
Yeah, my name is Ngolia Kimanzu. I work for the Swedish Cooperative Center, but also I'm a member of AgriCode, a network of agri agencies involved in agriculture and rural development, involving agri agencies in Europe, Canada, and Asia. I just came from Rome 2 days ago, where we were in deep discussions with IFAD on the role of farmers' organizations mm-hmm. in agricultural development. And from what you presented, Brian, I didn't see that as a focus in current work of activities. What plans do you have for the future? Because we know most of the programs that have been developed in the past, they have really left out farmers' organizations. They are not very strong in the development world, but they are quite important. And I think if you really want to address issues of poverty at a deeper level, you need to engage the farmers' organizations. Right now, we are discussing with IFAD also the question of development for results. How do we measure impact with the current systems that we have? We have a very robust data collection tool that we have developed together, and we are looking at how to get that processing integrated with the IFAD measurement of results system. I would like to have your comments on that, whether you see there's any or more room for future, for more deeper engagement with the platform.
Okay, thank you. Matthew, do we have any responses? No? Okay, please.
Here? I'm Kolai Yin. I just want to ask the first question. I want to ask Brian about something in Asia. May I ask that? Because I don't know if it is donor nation or not. Is it only donor nations that concern donor Asian?
The platform is made up of the donor yeah. as members, yes. Yeah. But obviously it must relate to the wider world.
Yeah, okay. I just want to ask
sorry
you.
Sorry to break it to you. Yeah.
I just ask you something that concerns Asians very much. And the discussion now going on is particularly in India and China. That is about the dumping of food. The dumping of food makes the farmers very difficult to sell their products because the dumping products are much cheaper because the relative country had very much subsidies. And that concerned the policy, the world policy. The second question is about the GM food. And you go to anywhere, they don't mention GM food, but in Asia, it is a war between the GM food and the traditional eco food. I don't know if you have a comment on that. It's very sensitive questions.
Thank you. Okay. Other questions, please? Anyone? Comments? Yes? You need the microphone, yeah.
My name is Rodolfo Lindquist. I am a bioenergy technologist and a farmer. And I just would like to know if the experiences I'm going to have in my planned sustainable agriculture in my farmland, it could be related somewhere else. Could I find people or organizations or farmers through this platform that they're doing or trying to do the more or less the same that I do in my farm?
Okay, thank you very much. I think we've got quite a few. We're going to.
I should probably take some answers perhaps before. If you want to do that,
yes, please. I'm listening.
Oh, actually, I guess I don't need the microphone. I can talk into this. Thank you all for those comments, and you've hit a few issues squarely on the head. Let me talk about this first one that a couple of you talked about, the relationship with other recipients, with civil society and members. The global donor platform is by definition donors. The genesis was, as I said earlier, the issue that donors themselves in their own organizations didn't feel they were getting enough resources. That meant the World Bank, it meant Africa Development Bank, it meant DFID, for example, were having problems within their own institutions, raising the profile of agriculture for their own programs, wanted to get together so they could lobby internally. And at the same time, we also recognize the importance of lobbying and advocating externally as donors. We realize that agriculture is a unique sector insofar as donors and all the public sector in recipient countries are not simply the equation. It's not like the health sector or the education sector, because you do have the private sector involved in agriculture and you do have civil society. And both those groups are able to join the platform as associate members. And we invite them to our annual general meetings and invite them to members. We had the annual general assembly the year before last in Tunis, in courtesy of hosted by the African Development Bank. And I well remember the first day's opening presentations on the platform. There was somebody from the platform, there was a bilateral donor, there was a representative from the private sector, in this case a group from East Africa, and there was Mohamed Sissoko from the farmers' organizations from West Africa. And each spoke and each contributed to the event. And in doing so, you are informing the donors of those particular perspectives. I spoke a lot about the private sector recently in this presentation, because if you like, that is the interface that is the greyest area for us. I'm very pleased to hear you are a DFAT, and I know that Marlene Ramirez from Fildra, who I've worked with a lot in the Philippines program, was at the farmers' organizations, and you'll know that EFAD has a lot of interaction with the farmers' organizations. But my question, the reason perhaps I didn't express it enough, was that we're already doing that. But when did you last come to EFAD for a private sector meeting? We don't quite know who to work with. No, we are working closely with civil society. We recognize, Gunilla, that it's an intrinsic part of that. When we did the presentation at the Busan High Level Forum, it was done with Filipino civil society. We work very closely with Better Aid, with the OEC DAC on the Busan group as well. We bring them into that dialogue. But we are responsive to what our donors want. If we start formally to represent civil society, we're beginning to move out of our comfort zone. We're into other people's territory. Other entities can say, well, hold on a minute, global platform. If you're an informal group of donors networking, you can't necessarily say you formally represent civil society or the private sector. But we absolutely and always emphasize the equation that rural poverty alleviation comes from a whole series of actors working together. On the question of and that also includes cooperatives, and I learned most of my work about cooperatives from Scandinavia, working with the Swedish Cooperative Federation in Zambia on smallholder credit, and seeing dairy cooperatives work in Norway. And a lot of those examples, this goes back to your question, those subsistence work that you're doing is relevant to our work. The feed into the platform, arguably, is through CEDA and through Sweet and through. And so when CEDA says to us in the platform, look, we really need to emphasize subsistence agriculture, there will be other members. I'm sure the Swiss, the Italians are going to say, yes, you know, they've got the. We want to emphasize that work. Are our donors doing? And I think they are. You'll hear from Elwyn Granger-Jones later this afternoon what EFAD's doing on natural resource management. A lot of that is developing those experiences. I think you can contact the platform directly. There's no problem with that. But also, if you can empower your own representative to push that message into the platform, it's going to carry a lot more weight. That, to some extent, responds to this issue about the food dumping, the prices, the subsidies. I mean, arguably, these are nationally driven policies. They're not something that the donors all agree or governments all agree to do. One could argue the issue of EC subsidies in the EC is an issue of a common agricultural policy. You know, I'll leave that to my prime minister to deal with that particular issue. These are national policies. We know that they're reflected. Again, when our members come through and say, we want to focus on an issue, we can take that through. We're only as strong, like a good cooperative, we're only as strong as what our members want us to do. And you know, on the GM issue, yes, I mean, of course it's controversial. Different donors have different perspectives. And we as a platform, sometimes we need to be careful. When we were leading up to the COP15 in Copenhagen, we produced a background paper on climate change. One of our members very strongly said, you can't say that. That's not our policy. We had to go back and say, look, you know, and we actually caveated the paper by saying, this does not represent the views of all the members, but it's a consensual view that this is a particular issue. So that's how we tend to deal with controversial issues on the
on the platform. I think if I can just finish on the CADEP, yes, it's been a key piece of work for IFAD. Going back several years, when CADEP itself said to us, we want the platform to help us interface with all the donors that you have working with you. Ibrahim Mayaki said, can you help us? So what the platform did and what its members agreed to do was that we agreed that one of our the Secretariat staff would act as a focal point for members and a facilitator for the CADEP donors in the CADEP process. And so for the last 4 or 5 years, we've had someone working with the donors task team, and the newsletter that Pascal put up on the screen is an output of that particular group. We do have a particular secretariat member, although he's moving on in a few months, who's the CADEP task team leader. But if you have information, and you're quite right, that's quite a controversial area, Pillar 4, agricultural research. If you could feed that piece of information in, we will push it out both to the CADEP group, but also to our group that's looking at agricultural research, and say, look, this is something that we need to address. I think that's Melinda. I've covered those points for now, but happy to take more.
Okay. Do we have further questions or input from? If I may ask a small question here about the technical side, I'm interested in when you talk about these different sharing documents and the database contacts and things like that. And okay, we'll get back to you. And I'm wondering if the different donors have security or confidentiality concerns that impede free exchange of information in some cases, and also the language. Does everyone publish in the same language, or do they write certain documents in their own languages, which are, in the case of Swedish, for example, of limited international viability?
Well, the communication within the network is in English. Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's obviously there's people communicating in other languages, but when it comes to the board and the working groups, that is almost exclusively in English. Mm-hmm. Just makes it easier. The information that is shared in a way is, I would think, probably not that confidential. What it's about is to get things going, and the draft documents that are put up, they're basically working together on documents that will come out later anyway. So it's not confidential in the more narrow sense. It's only that you don't want people to see what you just draft. So that's not really an issue, as if you want to feed in there, Brian, but I think from our experience, mm-hmm. is nothing to that effect. That's been a problem. And if it would be the documents in those share facilities are safe, so there's no issue with that.
Okay, good to hear. I think we had some results that we were going to come
My
back
apologies,
to.
Yes, there was a question on the results agenda, and it's again one of the work streams that's been regarded as important. As I said, all donors are being in these difficult financial times being asked to justify aid budgets, so delivering results and outcomes. Part of the work, and you saw that slide of David Hegwood from the US, member of the platform, who's part of the AVSI, which is the follow-up to the L'Aquila Food Initiative, where we're tracking results on that. And you'll see that came out strongly in the G8 presentation and conclusions at the Camp David meeting, to show results and to identify in particular six African countries known as the vanguard countries, where we will make an extra effort to show what results are being achieved. Ethiopia, Tanzania, and Mozambique, I think, Tanzania, Ethiopia, and Ghana are the three countries that we'll be particular targeting for results reporting.
Okay. I have another small question. In terms of results reporting for your own activities for the platform, you mentioned that some of the important things that you try to do are to avoid duplication. And we see a lot of similar donor initiatives and things that look like they might be a duplication. Do you have any evaluated results that the platform has managed to cut down on duplication or streamline something?
We haven't evaluated that particular issue. We're conscious of it. It's basically a theme or a mantra we keep circulating within our organizations. And I think insofar as we, all the platform members, try and we're actually going to do some mapping of this, we try and inform each and every member what it is we're doing. Mm-hmm. I must say, one of the things that interests me of coming to Swedish Cedar is to know exactly what Swedish Cedar is doing. We're looking at, and that's why the annual report is important, and that's why we also want to, one of the tasks we set ourselves for this year is to map out the principal activities of each of our members. So we know more to avoid duplication, mm-hmm. and to improve the ability to network. A little bit of a gray area yet. Mm-hmm. We're not yet ready to report on results. If you like, we're still in the basis of just defining the problem and how best to address the problem. Then we can go back and start saying how successful we've been in reducing the amount of duplication.
Okay.
I think, you know, from looking at the other tools work, it's obviously a thing. You could argue that if duplication has not happened because people talk to each other, that's uh-huh. something that is
difficult to measure.
Yeah. But I would turn this around and say if people do talk in our working groups, it would be hard that there would still be duplication if they still talk to each other. Mm-hmm. Maybe that just is one thing that can feed in there.
Yeah, very neat. Okay, are there more comments, suggestions, questions? Okay, no? Well, then I think we're a bit ahead of schedule. How do we deal with that? That's never happened to me, so I am at a loss. Okay. Right. Okay. We need to start the video sharp at 1:30, and therefore we can have a informal networking opportunity now until 5:25. And then please be back in your seats at 5:25 so that we can fumble with the technology for 5 minutes and everything will start on time. Thank you. Yeah.